start with electrostatics. जिनके पास हिंदी है, कभी उन्होंने संधि विक्षेप किया है, इसी तरह यहां पे भी आप इस वर्ड को संधि विक्षेप कर सकते हैं। दिस वर्ड यू कैन से कंसिस्ट ऑफ टू टर्म्स, इलेक्ट्रॉन्स प्लस स्टैटिक। इलेक्ट्रॉन करेस्पॉन्ड्स टू अ चार्ज, स्टैटिक मीन्स स्टेट ऑफ रेस्ट। तो ये टॉपिक अपने आप में क्लियर कर रहा है कि एग्जैक्टली हम लोग करने क्या जा रहे हैं इस चैप्टर में। व्हाट वी आर गोइंग टू डू इन इलेक्ट्रोस्टैटिक्स, इट डील्स विद द बिहेवियर एंड प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ द चार्जेस व्हेन दे आर एट रेस्ट। So various kinds of the fields you will study in this chapter which are due to a charge which is at rest. Now first thing, let us see methods of producing charge. Methods of charging bodies. How do we charge body? There are certain methods. Number one is by friction. How friction will help to charge a body? Suppose there is a body A and this is another body B. When these two bodies are rubbed together, after rubbing, what happens? Rubbing, you have seen in class 11th, when two bodies are rubbed together, what happens? Heat energy is generated, and this heat energy is actually received by the atoms, surficial atoms of this surface as well as surface of a body B. Now, once the amount of heat energy received by the body becomes enough to remove the electron from the surface, it removes electron from a particular body surface. I assume that electrons in a body A are loosely bound. So, body A removes electrons first, and these electrons are received by body B. When body A removes electron, it comes into deficiency of an electron, so we say it is positively charged. Body A gains positive charge. Body B receives negatively charged electrons in excess, so we call body B is negatively charged. Is that clear? That's how you can charge two bodies. This is also termed as frictional electricity, and you have learned so many examples in lower classes about frictional electricity. That is when glass rod is rubbed with silk, glass rod gains positive charge, then silk gains negative charge. Similarly, on rubbing ebonite rod with wool or fur, ebonite rod gets negatively charged, wool gets positively charged, and another example, when plastic was rubbed with woolen cloth, right, woolen cloth gains positive charge, then obviously plastic rod gets negatively charged. So even after using frictional method, you can understand number one, in which body electrons are loosely bound. Number two, which body is gaining electron and which body is receiving electron. Second method is by contact. By contact. Suppose there is a one body which is carrying positive charge. There is another body, you can call it as a sphere, which is uncharged. These two bodies are brought in contact with each other like this and then removed. When you remove, you will find body B is also gaining positive charge. Means some of the charge from body A is transferred to a body B. This is because of higher charge density on body A. So by nature, charges also move from higher level of charge to lower level. Now, if these two bodies are very much similar in shape and size and their capacitance are same, then whatever charge is carried by a body, when it is brought in contact with the body B, it is equally distributed. What do I mean equally distributed? If it carries charge Q, so after bringing in contact with B and then removing, A will carry QY2, B will carry QY2. That's how the charge is distributed. Third method is to produce charges by induction. By induction. Take two spheres and with insulated stand, so the charge could not flow into the ground, and these two spheres A and B are kept as shown in the figure. Now bring a positively charged glass rod. Positively charged glass rod near to this. I am not asking you to bring in contact with the sphere A. When you bring positively charged glass rod, negative charge is shifted towards this side, positive charge is shifting this side, this induces negative charge on this surface, positive charge is here. So if you continue with this, this charge will neutralize with this charge. So actually negative charge on this surface, positive charge on this surface will continue. Now remove these spheres a little distance apart. When you remove these spheres little distance apart and keeping glass rod is still there, this is negatively charged, this is got positively charged. Now slowly you remove this glass rod and leave it, then you will find that both the spheres are charged. Is that clear? So by induction, in the process of induction, charged bodies are never brought in contact with each other. I repeat in the induction again. Bring a positively charged glass rod near to the sphere A. It induces negative charge on a surface towards the glass rod on sphere A. Other side induces positive charge. The sphere B, which is closer to the other side of the positive charge side of the sphere A, positive charged side of the sphere A, here it induces negative charge, here it induces positive charge. So keeping glass rod still nearer to the sphere, remove these two and then remove glass rod. You will find the sphere A is carrying negative charge while sphere B carries positive charge. That's how the charge is being developed. Basic properties of charges. basic properties of charge. Number one, which is very important, is additivity of charge. This says the total charge given to a body or transferred to a body is equal to the algebraic sum of the charges given. Suppose, for example, this is a body A. First, I gave it to 2 micro plus 2 micro coulomb charge. Then I transferred again 6 micro coulomb charge. Then given -2 micro coulomb charge. Then what is total charge on body? +2 micro coulomb plus 6 micro coulomb plus -2 micro coulomb. So +2 minus 2 cancels. Net charge is +6 micro coulomb. So body is positively charged and it carries +6 micro coulomb charge. Right? Second is charge is conserved. Charge is conserved. That is conservation of charge. Conservation of charge. This is similar to conservation of energy, conservation of momentum, like that. So statement is very much parallel. The total charge for given isolated body or system remains constant. So total charge on a body is always constant. And third one is really very important, that is quantization of charge. What is quantization? It states that a body can have a charge equal to the integer multiple of fundamental electronic charge E, and this fundamental electronic charge E is equal to charge of an electron 10⁻¹⁹ coulomb. So it says body minimum can have this much charge, or multiple of this charge can be gained by the body or transferred by from one body to another body. Less than this charge is not possible for a body to keep. That is your quantization of charge. Now continue and coming to a very important topic, that is called Coulomb's law. You know Newton's law of gravitation. So Coulomb's law and Newton's law of gravitation are parallel. Parallel, I mean to say, number one, both are inverse square law. That is, force is varying reciprocal to the square of the distance. Newton's law talks about force acting between two mass objects. Coulomb's law will talk about force acting between two point charges. So what is the statement of the Coulomb's law? It states that the magnitude of force acting between two point charges. Two point charges are Q1, Q2, separated by distance r apart. So the magnitude of force acting between two point charges depends on F is directly proportional to the product of charges. There we had m1, m2, inversely proportional to the square of distance. So when you remove proportionality sign, you bring some proportionality constant as per mass. So F is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 over r square. The value of this constant 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught is 9 into 10 raised to the power 9 newton meter square coulomb square. And this is called epsilon naught is termed as electric permittivity. Permittivity of air or vacuum. So this value is also meant for air or vacuum. And value of epsilon naught for air or vacuum is 8.852 into 10 raised to the power minus 12 coulomb square newton meter square. Now, but force is a vector quantity. So the force vector, as a vector you can write F is equal to K Q1 Q2 over R square R cap. Now here we can discuss many cases. Case number one. When Q1 into Q2 is greater than 1, it means both are positive, then force is repulsive in nature. Case 2, when Q1, Q2 is less than 1, this shows force is attractive in nature. Case 3, definition of 1 coulomb. You can use this relation for, say I put, if Q1 is equals to Q2 is equal to Q, R is equal to 1 meter, and F is equal to 9 into 10 raised to the power 9 newton. When you keep it there, you will get Q is equal to plus minus 1 coulomb. So you can form a sentence for definition of 1 coulomb. You can easily form a sentence. 1 coulomb is an 1 coulomb, or 2 point charges are said to be 1 coulomb. 2 point charges are said to be 1 coulomb each if they repel or attract to each other by a force of 9 into 10 raised to the power 9 newton when separated by a distance 1 meter apart in air and vacuum. I repeat, 2 point charges are said to be 1 coulomb each when they repel or attract each other with a magnitude of force 9 into 10 raised to the power 9 newton when separated 1 meter apart in air or vacuum. Case 4. What can be case 4? See, when we talk about Coulomb's law, we are talking about 2 point charges Q1, Q2, and there is a force acting between them. Q1 exert force on Q2, Q2 exert on force Q1. So to represent these two forces by a single force is not justified. So I mark this force as force on Q1 by Q2 F12 is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 R to 1 square R to 1 cap force on Q2 by Q1, right? F21 is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 r12 square r12 cap. Since r21 equals to minus r12, this implies force F12 equals to minus F21. So these two forces are acting in opposite direction. So we can conclude here that Newton's law of gravitation follows Newton's third law. Follows Newton's third law. Now, if we say coordinates are changing, case 5, here one position vector shows that either of the charge must be at the origin, but if situation is not like this, situation is like this, that charge q1 is here, q2 is here, position vector of this is r1, this is r2, and we need this distance. Right? So, form of Newton's, Coulomb's law, force formula will change. You will put F is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 R square R cap, elaborating little more, 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 over vector r whole cube vector r, and we know here unit vector r is equal to vector r mod of r. But from triangle law r1 plus vector r is equal to vector r2, so vector r is equal to r1 minus r2. Therefore, force comes out to be 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. It is dying, so I am changing time now. 1 over force is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 mod of r1 minus r2 whole cube. R1 minus R2 vector. This will be a vector form. One more case we can discuss. When these two point charges, instead of air, are placed in some other medium, say water. So case 6, in air these two charges, magnitude of charges remain same, distance is kept same, only the medium is changed. They are placed in now some other medium. So in air we can say FA is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 over FA, mod of FA. Equals to this. And in other medium, mod of medium, electric permittivity will change for a medium, say epsilon m. Q1 Q2 over R square. So mod of FA over mod of FM is equal to epsilon M over epsilon naught. This is termed as epsilon R or K. We can represent it termed as relative permittivity or dielectric constant. So when you put these two charges in medium, mod of Fm is equal to mod of Fa over k, and since k is greater than 1 for any other medium than air, it means Fm is less than Fa. This helps us to explain even why water is a very good solvent. You know what actually is there? The dielectric constant of water is very high. So the moment any ionic salt like sodium chloride is put into the water, whatever force between sodium and chloride ion was there in the air, it drastically reduces from this factor. Because you see, if we talk about water, the dielectric constant of water is 81. So if I say, for example, this is just an arbitrary example, no experimental data. If I say Fa is equal to 81 Newton, right? And K is 81, so while you keep in water, its value reduces to 1 Newton. Now look at here, in air 81 Newton force was holding sodium ion and chloride ion, but once you kept it inside the water, only 1 Newton force is acting between sodium ion and chloride ion. It cannot hold these two ions together to form a sodium chloride molecule. As a result, sodium ion and chloride ion dissociates each other, and what sodium chloride gets easily dissolved in water. Let's take one NCERT example based on this. It's very simple and quick. You can do it even by yourself. It goes like this. What is the force between two small spheres having charge? There are two spheres, 2 into 10 raised to the power minus 7. Another sphere is carrying charge 3 into 10 raised to the power minus 7 coulomb. What is the force between them? When placed 30 cm apart in air. So state formula, 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 over r square, that is 9 into 10 raised to power 9, 2 into 3 into 10 raised to power minus 14, 3 into 3 square is 10 raised to power minus 2. When you solve all this, you will get 6 into 10 raised to the power minus 3 meter.